What a wonderful time this has already been this morning. Together with the body of Jesus Christ, the focal point of God, did you know what God happens to be doing in this era of his plan is working through his church? And every one of us are individual members of that body, both local entities of it as well as the entire one. Bonnie and I, by the way, are full-time servants of Christ Church. We travel 11 months a year to 4.5 of the continents and teach on an average of about 1,500 active duty servants of the Lord in training centers, 300 next generation ones. My spiritual biography, I thought we're at halftime, by the way. This is a fourth, and I have five more times I'm going to speak. And many of you I never get to personally talk to. So my biography or pedigree was I was saved at age 6, called to the ministry of the gospel at age 9. In preparation for that, read through the scriptures 100 times so I could teach it. I did my undergrad work at Michigan State, my bachelor's and master's and PhD work at Bob Jones University, my THM work at the Master Seminary, and my Doctor of Ministry work at Dallas Seminary. Went from all that, like many of you, I have enough degrees to have a temperature, and I went to pastor local churches. I've been married to Bonnie for 35 wonderful years, and I have a deep regret, and that is that I didn't meet her sooner, because she has had the most profound next to the Lord, sanctifying influence on my life. Together we raised 8 children. When you have children, as all of you know, you realize very soon that you're imperfect, they're imperfect, that you're an imperfect husband, you were married to an imperfect wife, and God gave you a whole bunch of imperfect children that you imperfectly raised for him. The good news is that the Bible says that God will never, and I will never, and you will never answer for how your children turned out. You only answer for how you raised them. You see, God doesn't expect perfection. He just longs for our obedience. We serve in 70-plus countries. One thing we do that's fascinating is we do a continuing education ministry for those who are in ministry. I have about 1,900 classes that are 1,800 or so that are hosted by a Buddhist facility called Google. And, you know, all those people in Silicon Valley are Zen this and that. But they offer free of charge through YouTube subscriptions for students. And we have, you can see up there about, it's too small on my screen, but about 85,000 or 83,000 students, subscribers. And they're in 120 countries. And I just basically teach courses in how to read the Bible, how to study the Bible, how to memorize the Bible, how to pray, how to interpret the Bible, and then go through every, you know, major doctrine, and they do that. And I think what's interesting, one of them is Q&As. You notice the top five are all Q&As, which we're going to do tonight. And I'm amazed that, you know, that end one, that a million people want to watch, why did God create the tree of good and evil if he knew? And the rest of the question is, man and woman were going to fall into sin. Why did he put it there if he knew it? And the up-and-coming one, I think it's fascinating, that fourth one over, God says there's 7 events coming. And we just posted that at Christmas, and it's got 600,000 people that have watched it. It's because people are seeing something's happening rapidly. I mean, our global warming has turned into a polar vortex, which is going to go back into an even greater global warming. And the Middle East has never been so volatile as now, and everything else seems to be falling apart. The question-answer framework, and by the way, we put most of that training thing on a flash drive, and one of you from northern, largest country in the world, you know, capital Beijing, came to me on my first day and said, the flash drive you gave out to us 2 years ago, I lost. And I said, I'm sorry, I'll mail you one, but I went through my suitcase and I found it. So whoever you are, do you remember? There you are right back there. I'd throw it to you, but come up to me afterward because I can't throw that far. And I have one, praise the Lord. But we do offer that, especially for those in remote areas that can't stream. It's 128 gig, 4K. high resolution so that you can see it on any device and also use it in other means. But the framework for my question and answer, and I just unashamedly say, I can't believe that people watch this because I have a very conservative framework. And that is evangelical, that a person must be saved. In other words, you don't get saved by association. Just like a car in a garage doesn't make you a car if you go in a garage, so going to church doesn't make you a Christian. You must be born again. So I'm evangelical. That's what that word means. You believe in the gospel. I'm an inerrantist, which means the scriptures are inspired. The reason I believe the scriptures are inspired and the problem that most people that don't believe that have is that Jesus affirmed the scripture. Jesus affirmed the historicity of Adam, Eve, Noah, the flood, Jonah, being swallowed by a large aquatic creature, and every other scoffed at part of the Bible by most mainline American denominations. Jesus believed the scriptures were inspired. That's a real problem. Then you wonder, what are those denominations following if they don't even believe what Jesus believed? So, but I don't want to be, petty about it, but it is major. I'm also a cessationist only in this sense that there's no longer any scripture being inspired. Be careful if someone says, God told me. I mean, when they say that to you, say, wait a minute. Now, is what you're saying equal with this is the voice of God that he left for us? Is what you're telling me you just heard on the same level? Rarely will anyone do that. They go, oh, no, but the Lord laid on my heart. I say, oh, he lays on my heart too. Don't tell me God told me, because God only speaks the truth. And if you tell me what God told you, God only speaks the truth. You're a conduit of scripture? Oh, no, I'm not. I say, okay, let's be real cautious there. Because there's a movement afoot where people claim that. They claim that they have revelations from God. The scriptures, as we're in Revelation, says, God says, don't add to my word. So we should be careful. So I'm a cessationist in that sense, that God is not, he does not have apostles writing scripture or prophets like in the Old Testament. An imputationist, only Christ saves. Christ alone, not a church, not an experience, not an administered sacrament, not doing something to someone, only Christ saves. It must be his imputed righteousness. I'm a creationist, and only for this reason. By the way, my early work before the Lord got a hold of my heart was I was involved in data transmission on lasers and had a scholarship to MIT to do that. I was totally into science. And what is fascinating to me is that the longer scientists work, the more they are corroborating and getting in line with everything the Bible says scientifically. Now, there's only one part of this book I'm holding that God actually wrote with his own hand, right? All of you know it, because you all have memorized it, and it's called the Ten Commandments. Remember the finger of God in a stone tablet that Moses brought to him. Did you know that God, in Exodus 20, said to the Jews who were slaves in Egypt, he said, for as I created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, you should work for 6 days and rest the seventh. I've heard endlessly people say, well, the creation account is kind of like a, it's kind of like, and they're trying to say that it's a nice thing, but it must be billions and billions and billions of years, and a day means a million or a billion years or an eon or an epoch or an age or an indiscernible period of time, but it didn't happen to mean that to God. And when God talked directly to 3 million people from Mount Sinai to his chosen people of promise that he made a covenant with, he said, just like you've had to make bricks 6 days a week for the Egyptians, 6 solar days, I made the entire universe. I didn't remake it. I didn't build it on top of a pile of death and destruction. I made everything from nothing in 6 solar days. Now, that's what God believed. It doesn't mean that you have to believe it, but I believe it because God said it. And what's fascinating is I was sitting at the pantry in downtown Los Angeles at 9th and Figueroa reading the Los Angeles Times, that great organ of evangelical thought. And it said, as I sat there at the counter eating, it said, did you know, this was an article, it says, in the studies of the mountains that are right above, San Bernardino and all that, just overlooking Los Angeles Basin, it said that there were glaciers up there about 5,000 years ago. I thought, I know that. I'm glad they just figured it out. Because I'm also a catastrophist. That means that Noah's flood really happened on every inch of this planet. And it covered every mountain. And that's why you find sea life, sea creatures, on the top of every, I mean, from the Himalayas to the Andes to everywhere in between. Because the whole earth was overspread with blood. I'm also a maximalist. What is that? That's not, the Gladiator movie. But maximalist is that the Bible, if it's inspired, all those wonderful passages that all of you just quoted, you really believe those are true. Now, as W.A. Criswell, the great pastor of the First Baptist Dallas, once said, he said, Jesus made the Bible like a sweater. He affirmed all of it's true, and as soon as you start pulling out little parts of it that you say aren't true, you're unraveling the whole thing, and you can't trust any of it if it's not all true. The Bible affirms some very powerful truths about morality, about history, about the spiritual world, especially the unseen spiritual world. Only God knows about that. And also about history and science. And anytime God speaks on any of those topics, I'm a maximalist. I believe it's true and that we can trust it and it's reliable and sufficient. And finally, you probably heard the term dispensationalist, and I picked that up in one of those schools that I was at. Basically, to understand the Bible is to understand that God has a separate plan for Israel than the church, and the church is not Israel. And that undermines this whole kind of movement about health, wealth, and prosperity, because those promises God gave to Israel about, you do this and I'll give you the land, he didn't actually give those to the church. Israel had a land that he promised to them. So, but that's kind of eighth, because it's not critical and vital. One thing I would like to tell you is that this series, for the nine times I'm speaking, are Christ's Last Words to His Church. It's actually part of my dissertation, part of what I got my doctoral work in. All 424 pages, it's a book, are downloadable. It's a PDF on your WOVA app. If you just go back in time to Wednesday, February 20th, the 7:45 a.m. Spiritual Life event that's on, I checked this morning, it's still there. Bruce said it'll erase like Mission Impossible in 3 months. It just goes away. But the whole thing, if you want the whole book, it's a PDF on there. I mean, everything that I have is on Amazon everywhere else, but I mean, it's free on the WOVA app. And if you want to listen and watch it, I mean, because I have the video form of it, it's also on YouTube. But this morning, let's go to Revelation 2 and verse 1, and we're going to look at the first of the seven churches in our time before it's time to pick up our kids and go to lunch. Revelation chapter 2, and I've entitled this section, Ephesus, that's the first church that Jesus addresses, the three secrets of a powerful church. Now, the thing about this is, if God puts Ephesus at the front of the line, if God commends Ephesus with 10 incredible commendations, more than any other church, and if God says to them that they are so great, and he did say that, then we should wonder how did Ephesus get like that? The saints at Ephesus were heirs to the Apostle Paul's longest and most powerful ministry, 3 years. He stayed here longer than any other city, and when he left, he passed the pastoring of the church down to his spiritual son, Timothy. And Paul sent back not one, he sent back three letters to them. He sent back what we call the epistle to the Ephesians, which is the content that he taught them. He also sent to their pastor, Timothy, 1 Timothy, and 2 Timothy. And he told him, don't cry so much and, don't be afraid and all that, because Timothy was following Paul in the greatest church of the ancient world. And this is where Jesus' mother Mary lived and died in Ephesus. And it was from here that John was arrested by Domitian and exiled to Patmos. And there were notable Christian leaders, just a galaxy of them that went there, Apollo and Tychicus and Priscilla and Aquila. And if you ever want to read church history, Priscilla and Aquila, when do you ever hear someone say Mrs. and Mr.? I mean, if you speak English and I said, hello, I'd like you to meet Mrs. and Mr., you'd think that I stuttered or something, because we always say Mr. and Mrs. I mean, it's just kind of a form in the language. Why is it Priscilla and Aquila? Because Prisca, that's her name, was from a senatorial family. Her family is one of the wealthiest in Rome. And she came to Christ. And her probably father, or maybe it would be another relative, but someone is the only of those who became a Roman tribune that were deposed as a tribune, most likely because he came to Christ. So, I mean, wow, famous people went to this church, and many others ministered. But Timothy pastored there until he was martyred by a mob. Did you know that? He stuck to it and wasn't afraid and stopped crying, and they killed him. It was the largest church. In fact, Eusebius said it reached 50,000 people. But the saints of Ephesus overcame what I call the very same pressures facing every one of us today. A pleasure-seeking culture, a mind-assaulting media, and a materialism-dominated way of life. Now, maybe out in the reaches where you serve, there isn't a lot of that. But for most people in Western society, they're living in a pleasure-seeking culture, a mind-assaulting media, I would even say mind-numbing media, and a materialism-dominated way of life. And for 40 years, Ephesus stood as a beacon in one of the darkest places of the Roman Empire. Isn't that interesting? The greatest church of Jesus Christ was in the darkest place and glowed brightly. It was Jesus' most powerful church. And so Ephesians 2, 1 to 7 describes for us what I call Jesus' most successful church. And if we don't do anything else today, I would love for us to read this. And out of respect for the Word of God and to help us focus on it, if you can, would you stand together with me for the reading of God's Word? You follow along. Remember, there's a blessing for me to read, for you to listen, and for all of us to hear what God has to say. But Revelation 2, starting in verse 1, to the angel of the church of Ephesus, write, "These things says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your labor, your patience, that you cannot bear those who are evil, and you have tested those who say they're apostles and are not, and have found them liars, and you have persevered and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary." And what you just heard are nine commendations. There's another one coming. I'll point it out. Verse 4. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do. By the way, those are imperatives. Three in a row. Remember, repent, do. It's always the same formula. The first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. But this you have, here's the tenth one, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Verse 7, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you would open your word to each of our hearts, that you would use your truth by your Spirit to stir us at the deepest level of our being, to make conscious choices, surrenders, decisions, resolves, that we would be more conformed to your image today because we gathered as your people. In the name of Jesus, we pray, and all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Ephesus was Jesus' most successful church. The first of the seven churches Jesus writes is Ephesus. It was the largest church. It was the most successful. No church receives more commendations than Ephesus. The church at Ephesus was in top spiritual condition, optimal health, except for this heart problem. And when Jesus warns them to repent, he says, return, go back to what you were doing at the beginning. That's we see. We get to see what loving Jesus most looked like. And that's kind of exciting. So to recap, the church at Ephesus had the longest ministry investment of Paul, the greatest revival of the New Testament era. I mean, what happened in Ephesus is unparalleled. The largest church of ancient church history, the first love church, Jesus says, you are the quintessential example of what that first love looks like. And also, it's the most detailed words on spiritual warfare and the commands of Ephesians 6. I mean, they knew how to wage spiritual warfare as those who love Christ most. Well, Ephesus happened to be the home of the third wonder of the ancient world. And when Jesus wrote this list of commendations and the serious warnings and a promise, he sends it by messenger through John, recording it and taking it down to Patmos's port and getting it on a boat. And that boat sailed from Patmos into the port at Ephesus. And the moment that that messenger sailed in and walked into that city holding the letter from Jesus, the first thing you would have seen would not have been the bustling harbor teeming with boats and all the roads, by the way. The roads were lined with all the exotic goods all the way from the furthest extents of the empire. But he would have seen the largest building ever constructed in the ancient world. Not the largest structure. Pyramids, you know, are big, and the Roman roads were quite a building project, but the largest single building ever built was the Temple of Ephesus. It was 10 stories high and covered what we would call a city block. It was an amazing structure. The Temple of Diana, or Artemis in the Greek language, was completely covered and overlaid with gold. It stood gleaming in the sun directly at the center of the city. It became number 3 of the 7 wonders of the ancient world. By the way, when it was constructed, it wasn't inside the city. They never put their temples inside the city, but Ephesus grew so big that gradually the city surrounded it. But it was amazing. Around Diana's temple, prostitutes, both men and women prostitutes, would lure people into unbridled immorality. That's one of the ways that you worship Diana. She was a goddess of sex and fertility, and hundreds of temple prostitutes were always on the grounds. And they promoted an unrestrained indulgence of the flesh. So you can imagine, Ephesus was a magnet. Not just for the sexually enslaved, but it was the center of the black arts. Now remember, Satan promotes all the things that kill and steal and destroy people. And so anything you can do to enslave them, whether it be the prostitution or the witchcraft or the superstition, all of it draws Satan's attention. This third wonder of the ancient world was the center of everything that went on in the city. It stood for all to see in the center of it a huge 70 or so foot high pornographic statue of the goddess Diana. And if you've ever seen the representations of it, it was out of black stone, and that culture surrounding that statue fostered materialism and pride and occultism and sensuality and demon worship. So, not a very nice place to visit. I mean, kind of like, I don't know, the seedy side of Bangkok and the seedy side of San Francisco and a little bit of the glitz of L.A. and New York and with all the lights of Shanghai and just put it on steroids. That was Ephesus. And the spiritual hosts of wickedness were out in full force, and they shamelessly advertised everything God hates. And that's the spot God chose to plant a church. Probably we wouldn't. God did. If you turn back with me to Acts 19... God plants a church in that city, and this is the record of it. And if you really want to know what makes a church powerful, we only see it in full bloom powerful in the commendations. But how it got that way is what Acts 19 is about. And this is Paul's longest ministry. I call Ephesus a city on a hill, even though it wasn't. It was in a harbor. But the idea of the city on the hill that everyone can see, the light, is what I'm talking about. But God planted his church to be truly a city on the hill, a light in a very dark place. But also he picked a strategic place. Next to Rome, Ephesus was number 2. Next to Rome, Ephesus was most influential. And the trade routes to the ends of the empire and the commercialism and the center of all this pantheon of the Greco-Roman superstition cultic worship was right there. plus that third wonder, the ancient world. Ephesus wasn't just a major seaport. It was also as the gateway to the entire continent of Asia. It was a city where four major trade routes would cross. So it was kind of like the hub, kind of like the port at Singapore or the Shanghai port that has the most containers going out of it. It was just the place that if you were in business, you were something to do with Ephesus. It was a city that was, through its seaport and from there, the hub of Rome. Now remember, Rome was inland. It had Ostia, but it wasn't a port. The port of Rome truly was the city of Ephesus. Well, what a better place could Jesus put his lamp, his church, to shine the light of the gospel to all the world. Ephesus quickly became the major publishing house of the ancient world. Because of the port, they could promulgate literature. So if you had a book, you took it to the library of Celsus area, which still stands there. All of you that have gone to, you know, on when you're in any tour of the biblical world in Turkey, you go to see Ephesus and you see that big two-story building. That's the Library of Celsus. And that was the major publishing house of the ancient world. Every letter circulating among the churches came through Ephesus first. When Paul sent a letter, he sent it to the church, and they immediately had the copies made, but some would get it to Ephesus where it could go widely across the known world. The missionaries were sent from here. Pastors would get their start here. From Ephesus, everyone who passed through and heard the gospel took it with them to the ends of the world. Do you see why the Lord wanted Ephesus? That's where we get to Acts 19:10. Look what it says. And this continued for 2 years, so that all who dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. Now, this is the Roman province of Asia. That's what we would call modern-day Turkey. But it was the beginning. Everything that Paul taught for those 2 years as he dialogued with the people, everything that was being trained, what we would call the whole book of Ephesus, to put off and put on and be renewed and spiritual warfare and being seated in Christ, all that just went to the ends of the earth. And so it's very possible that the other six churches of Revelation 2 and 3 were actually products from what went on in Ephesus. So it's amazing. This church had the most powerful founding of all the churches. Well, what would be the biography? Many notable authors have written books about what makes a successful church. I mean, in the 70s and 80s, that was one of the biggest publishing things in America, you know, the secrets of how to build a big church. But if God were to write a manual on how to make a church successful, what would he say the secret is? Well, he already did. He did write the manual, and he did tell us the secret. Acts 19 is the authorized biography of the most successful church. And by the way, God wrote the biography. So it's amazing to think of what we have in our hands. In chapter 19, we find the timeless keys of what God did to make a church he can use greatly. By the way, I don't see any of those keys being promoted in my home country widely. And it shows how much our commercialism and our business minds, in fact, if you're going to have a good church, you've got to get all the elders to be good businessmen, right? That's what we're looking for. The rich, the powerful, the successful, the most educated. Not the ones that know the Bible best, not the ones that walk in holiness most, but those who are respected and powerful. Yet God says in 1 Corinthians 1, God hasn't chosen the rich of this world and the mighty and the powerful. He's chosen the weak so that, as one of my friends said that did a ministry, he says, I want to do something that when it happens, there'll be no way to explain it, so God will get all the credit. That's not how it is nowadays. The people want to get all the credit, and they publish it, and, you know, and in Christendom, they became famous. Well, throughout history, in every culture, no matter what century it is, what does a powerful and successful church look like to God? He tells us. He starts in verse 11. Number one, and let me read to you starting in verse 11, down through 17. Now, God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul. That's an understatement. Paul unusually served in this place. It was the most amazing outpouring of God's power anywhere he was. So that even handkerchiefs or aprons Now, let's be specific. Handkerchiefs and aprons. What would that be? You know, you just can see the, you know, the Norman Rockwell housewife and her apron at the stove and, you know, a handkerchief. No, this is the leather workers who had sweat rags and that apron that they wore so that when they were working and everything that they could protect their clothes. So Paul was working in Ephesus like he worked everywhere else, and he had the normal things that it wasn't like he bought them at the, you know, Lifeway store or the, you know, the whatever the denominational store is. He didn't buy holy stuff, holy hardware. It's just his normal everyday stuff. People would come in, and when Paul was working away at his work, when he wiped his head and put the rag down, disappeared. That's what it's saying. Look, that even handkerchiefs or aprons were brought from his body. This is while he's working. And by the way, he didn't say, if you donate $100, I'll send one to you. See how far we've come? They just stole them. Brought from his body to the sick, the diseases left them. Wow. I think we read that too fast. Paul was radiating the power of God in an unusual way for those 3 years that he was in that city. And it didn't stop with disease. Look at that. And the evil spirits went out of them. You could go dragging that apron. Now, there was a time when Peter's shadow, do you remember that? Peter's shadow, when Peter and John walked through the temple, his shadow healed people, you know, in those early days right after Pentecost. His shadow. But now, for 3 years, if you could get cloth that touched Paul's body, unbelievable. Verse 13. And there were some itinerant Jewish exorcists who took upon themselves to call the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, "We exorcise you by the Jesus whom Paul preaches." And there were also seven sons of Siva, a Jewish chief priest, who did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, "Jesus I know, and Paul I know." Now pause there. By the way, demons, evil spirits, fallen angels, are in the spirit world. As far as we know, they're invulnerable. They travel through, you know, physical barriers with no problem. They've been alive for thousands of years since creation. They know every language. They listen in on everything. They don't sleep as far as we know. They don't need to eat as far as we know. And by the way, the word demon is the Greek word for intelligence. So they are these supernatural, powerful beings that are highly intelligent. And so they says, "Boy, yeah, we know Jesus and we know Paul. Who are you?" Then the man, verse 16, in whom the evil spirit was, leaped on them. Oh, evil spirits can energize those that they possess. That's very interesting. The Bible, demon possession is a difficult word because it never, that is not in the Bible. It never says anybody's possessed. The word is diamond, you know, demonizomai. It's they're demonized. And so a lot of people think that demons, you know, can possess Christians. A demon can't possess a Christian because the Holy Spirit's already in there. We're sealed. But demons can enter objects. Pigs, snakes. Satan went into a snake and talked through it and look at the problems we're all into. And people. And when he does, or they do, those demons, the people have supernatural strength. Wow. So this guy, there's an example. And he leaped on them, verse 16, overpowered them, and prevailed. Ischuo is a Greek word. He just overcame them. I mean, unbelievable. One person overcame seven. Boom. And it says, so that they all fled from the house naked and wounded. I mean, he really got them. And they're running out screaming for their lives. And this became known both to all Jews and Greeks dwelling in Ephesus. And fear fell on them all. And the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. Point number one, Jesus, God's Son, is magnified. That's the first secret of a powerful church. Did you notice who wasn't magnified? The guy that's given out the handkerchiefs. The guy that's given out the aprons. The guy the demons know his name. He's not magnified. Now, isn't that interesting? We live in a completely different era. We like to magnify the tool instead of the one that energizes, fills, and uses the tool. God's Son was magnified. In a materialism-dominated, pleasure-seeking culture like Ephesus, religious opportunism abounded. But when the Apostle Paul arrived, he refused to be another religious peddler. Instead of living off the hardworking people of Ephesus, he found a way to support himself. He took a job as a leather worker. Paul wanted nothing to stand in the way of his message, so he labored day and night with his own hands. He taught the word of Christ to any who would listen during the citywide afternoon siesta. That's how he did it. If you know anything about the Roman world, they took a longer siesta than, you know, South America and Europeans do. They had this whole afternoon deal. And Paul would lecture for hours every day during the siesta. Amazing. And again on weekends. Leather workers always had two things with them when they worked: their thick apron to protect them from the sharp tools they used, and a sweat rag so they wouldn't drip sweat and stain the leather. Now look what God did with the tools of Paul's trade. God worked unusual miracles through them. The first secret of a powerful church is God's Son is magnified. There's power in Jesus that can't be faked, that can't be counterfeited. No matter how much money is in the offering plate or how many people are in the Sunday morning service, the church has no power if Christ isn't magnified. They have a big building and a big budget, but they don't have power for transformed lives. And this was unlike any time in Paul's ministry, and I don't need to go into that because we don't have enough time or you'll miss lunch. So let me just say that amazing things happen. But number two, look at starting at verse 18. It says, and many who believed came confessing and telling their deeds. Now look at 19. And many of those who had practiced magic brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all, and they counted up the value of them, and it totaled 50,000 pieces of silver. That's a humongous sum. But what does it mean? Well, number two, the second secret of a powerful church is not only that God's Son is magnified, but God's people are consecrated. Remember I said to you a couple days ago that in many American churches, you can be in the worship team on the platform, sleeping with your boyfriend, and doing various and sundry other things, and no one interferes with your life because we're under grace. Who am I to judge? That's why many churches perform world-class music. They could package it and sell it, get it on iTunes and make a fortune. But all they're doing is promoting themselves, many of them. And there's no power of transformation. Why? Because the secret of a powerful church is when Christ is magnified and when God's people are consecrated. When Paul originally began spreading the gospel in Ephesus, he was not talking to commendable, God-honoring saints. What were the people of Ephesus like? It says in Ephesians 2. They formerly walked according to the course of this world. They were energized by the god of this world, Satan. Remember, Jesus said the same thing. Jesus never read any of those stories about how to win friends and influence people. He always said stuff that offended everybody and just made them want to kill him, and they did. But do you remember what Jesus told the religious people? He said, you are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, didn't abide in the truth, and neither do you. Now, he wasn't just talking to religious professionals. We're all of our father the devil. That's why we have to be born again. That's why salvation is by association. You don't get saved by being around Christians. You get saved by having a brand new operating system installed inside. It is supernatural. It is a new heart, a new spirit. We already talked about that in Ezekiel 36. We all once conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, Paul said to the Ephesians, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath. So what were the people that Paul won to Christ that formed the most powerful church in the world that ended up getting consecrated? What did they get consecrated from? Well, they were Diana-worshipping, sex-addicted, materialism-controlled, occult-practicing sinners. That's what they were. Isn't it interesting that the controversial British sports superstar that was also a multimillionaire industrialist and landholder in England in the 1860s by the name of Charlie Thomas Studd, isn't it interesting that that man, by the way, his cricket records still are in Eton. Many of his records have never been surpassed. He was that great of a sportsman in England. But God called him first, you know, to China, and he didn't do very well. Then he went to India, and he didn't do very well. And then he went to the heart of Africa. And he got there in, I think, about 1910, and he lasted till about 19, maybe 32, something like that. He only took with him to the heart of Africa two Bibles wrapped in oilcloth because he didn't want to have them ruined in the canoe ride. He knew the only way that God would transform the people he wanted to reach was through the scriptures. And all of you know, and I will summarize his 20-plus year ministry this way. When he entered Africa, he described the people as fiendish, cannibalistic, naked savages who went into frenzies and would leave the frenzies in murderous under the influence of the darkness and would kill each other and savage and rape and plunder and everything else. And he taught them the word of God so that at his death, he died of a baseball-sized gallstone, which must have really hurt for a long time. And he died laying on his cot, and his son-in-law tells us that 20,000 of those former cannibals, pygmy cannibals, surrounded him with oiled bodies, wearing banana leaves, because when they got saved, they didn't want to be naked anymore, singing the hymns, 20,000. Now, I'm not sure how son-in-law counted them, but it doesn't matter. Something happened there, just like happened here. God saved those addicts of Ephesus. But he didn't leave them there. Paul began to teach them what pleases God, what doesn't please God. And all of a sudden, these recently dead, made alive in Christ saints heard God's rebuke. And this is where chastening comes in. Their eyes were open. They saw all the things in their lives that didn't glorify God, and they started cleaning house. Look what it says in 1918. And many who had believed, so they've already become Christians, they came confessing and saying, hey, Christ in me is not happy with what I'm doing, and I want to change. And they, look what they did. Many of those who had practiced magic brought their books together and burned them. And they didn't sell them on eBay, by the way. Let someone else be polluted by it, you know. They just destroyed them. This is what consecrated living looks like. They had been living in the lust of flesh, so when they felt the rebuke of the Lord, they went through their homes, they found everything that promoted sensuality, everything that promoted the lust of the flesh, and they cleaned it out. They used to walk according to the course of the world, according to materialism, according to the pursuits big in Ephesus. So they cleaned out everything that promoted that. If it made them indulge in the desires of the mind and their own pride, they got rid of it. This is what they were saved from. And they chose not to live in it anymore. Everything that God's enemies, the evil one and his angels, were promoting in Ephesus, the saints in Ephesus decided they wouldn't be ruled by those things anymore. What Satan was promoting, they wouldn't be ruled by. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. I just put it this way. They chose to not give Satan a foothold in their lives. That's what it says in Ephesians 4. We know what Paul taught in those long sessions every afternoon at the school of Tyrannus, where he for over 2.5 years taught them. He taught them not to give Satan a foothold, it says in Ephesians 4. What's that? A landing place. Don't let him in. Because once he lands, he'll in your life and gets a foothold in you. Once you get that sin that you're willing to grieve and quench the Holy Spirit for because you don't want to give it up, that landing place, he doesn't inhabit us. But he can shoot those fiery darts in and start smoldering fires of desires, fears, anxieties, bitterness, all the stuff Satan operates in. And so they chose not to give Satan a foothold by getting rid of every occultic object and book they owned. That's why Paul tells the Ephesians they're not fighting flesh and blood, but against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places in chapter 6. So in order to put on the armor of God, to shield themselves against all the temptation and flaming arrows of the evil one, they chose not to put temptations intentionally before their eyes. That's interesting. They didn't just close it all up in a drawer. They dragged it out into their front lawns and set it on fire. God's church is always strongest when it's purest. The level of their desire to repent and follow the Lord was seen in their costly choices to rid their lives of anything that displeased God, which should stir us to ask, have we likewise carefully purged out of our lives anything that displeases the Lord? One of the biggest reasons that people refuse to come to church is because of all the hypocrisy. And it's there. It's there. When God's people are consecrated, the church has power the whole world can see. Well, the ending. Now look at Acts 19, 9, 10, and then all the way down into verse 20. Verse 9. But some who were hardened and did not believe but spoke evil of the way before the multitude, he departed from them and withdrew the disciples, reasoning daily in the school of Tyrannus. And this continued for 2 years, so that all who dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord. So Paul moved away from the synagogue, moved into a public place, and began his daily dialogues. Now look at what happens in verse 20. So the word of the Lord grew mightily and prevailed. What's the third secret of a powerful church? God's Son is magnified, God's people are consecrated, and God's word prevails. Here in Ephesus, Paul didn't just plant a church and move on. He began teaching daily in the synagogue. He reasoned and persuaded concerning the things of God. By the way, dialogue is a very important part of what the church needs to do. That's why these Q&A sessions are the most watched things we have on our channel. Why? Because people want to understand how to connect the problem they have with the scripture, and most people don't know how to put it together. Paul, dialogizmai, he went through, he says, what are you dealing with? Okay, this is what God said. And by the way, he used the Old Testament, no less, and connected them to God. After 3 months of Paul ministering, some people began to speak out against him. So he moved to a lecture hall, the school of Tyrannus. And that's when the word really began to spread. For 2 years, every single day, Paul would come from his leather shop on his lunch break and explain the scriptures. The word dialogizomai is where we get the word dialogue. It means to talk through, to reason through. He didn't just read the word, he explained it. In fact, when I worked for John MacArthur, I said, can you tell me your secret? He said, I'm an explanatory preacher. You know, it kind of sounds like Lucy. You got some splaining to do. You know, John says, I explain the Bible so people can understand it. He got that from Paul. For 2 years, every single day, when the whole city was taking an afternoon siesta, people would gather to hear Paul. Counting the time he had on Sundays and every day for 2 years, Paul preached a total of 3,000 hours to this one church. That's the equivalent of attending Sunday morning services, Sunday evening services, and Wednesday night services for 30 years. In other words, Paul condensed a lifetime of learning into 3 years for this church. Once God's word prevails, the church has power that lasts for generations. Well, what these people do? They loved what God loves. They hated what God hated. Look how Jesus commends him. He said, I know your works, your labor, your patience. You can't bear those who are evil. You test those who say they're apostles and are not. You show them to be liars. You persevere, kind of repeats himself. You have patience and have not become weary. God put his stamp of approval on them. He did something that Jesus commends not. They were doing something Jesus commends three times. Not once, not twice, but three times. Notice what he says. He says, first, you cannot bear those who are evil. Secondly, he says, and you have tested those who are apostles and are not. And third, you found them liars. they were exercising 1 Thessalonians 5:22, testing all things. They tested for truth. Wow. Ephesus had access to all of Paul's letters, not just letters written to this church. They had them all. And so they confronted evil and error. Well, the secret of a powerful life, Ephesus was the most powerful church. God gifted Ephesus with more incredible pastors than any other church. And when everything was added together, all 10 wonderful God-honoring areas of their lives, Jesus said, "You are the most powerful church." But two generations later, he says, "I have something against you. You're still going through the motions, but you've lost your love supremely for me." The bottom line, their lives didn't add up to Jesus Christ. So Jesus admonished them to love God most. How do we do that? By being consecrated, by magnifying Christ, by letting his word loose. By the way, what would be burned up today if the Spirit's conviction swept our churches? I wonder if some, you know, Prime video watching and some Netflix watching would be kind of set to the side. Acts tells us that when God's people were consecrated, the result was that God's word grew mightily and prevailed. It's amazing. The power of the early church was simply genuine holiness. Energized by grace, they magnified Christ. God's word prevailed in them, and they lived consecrated lives. What does that look like? Well, the Spirit of God moved unhindered. He flowed unquenched. Did you know the Holy Spirit is a person and he has emotions? He gets grieved and quenched by us. His power is quenched and he is grieved when we love what God hates, when we allow sin to be undealt with in our lives. God gets all the glory. No one competed for the credit. No one sought to be in control. God reigned. The Spirit moved. And Christ was magnified. So the bottom line is, the secret to a powerful life is simply to love God most. When we love God most, we're consecrated. Christ is magnified. And the word fills our life. And the choice is ours. I'm going to close in prayer. Michael's going to come up while I'm praying, and he's going to close us with a song, and then we're going to go to lunch and get our kids and try and never forget what Jesus wants from us. Let's bow. Father, I pray that we would love you more than anything else, and we would hate what you hate, and that you would stir us up to get rid of those things in our lives that displease you, and to let you unabashedly be magnified and flow through us, consecrating us so that your word touches lives. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. 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 Jesus, we pray. Amen.